Well, I was born in July the 4th, 1922, south of Pawnee, to poor parents that worked by the month on the farm, my dad did. My dad's name was Homer and mother's name was Nellie. Then I went to start the school at South Cotton Hill School. That's just a little bit out south of Beamington, Illinois. And I know
it's not even
I know
there
nobody
anymore.
Knows where that's at because the school's not there anymore, but I can show you exactly where it was at. We live about 3 miles from there. That was pretty tough. Dad used to come and get us in a horse and wagon. During the Depression, I worked on the farm, and tractors were just coming in, and man, that was in my blood somehow. And I couldn't hardly stand to work horses when there was a tractor anywhere in the neighborhood. The owner had a Model T Ford, 1917 Ford Roadster. And I learned how to drive it, and taking water and running errands within on the farm with it. I remember I used to get that thing out in the pasture and nobody around. I'd pull the ears down on it, so to speak, that hand throttle. And then I'd put on the brakes, and it just had brakes on a rear wheel, and just spin around on that grass, and I thought that was great fun.
They used to take Tag's sister and put her on a Victrola?
Yeah, we thought that was fun.
They thought it was fun.
We set the baby the baby on the old turntable, you know, and that kid gets... We'd laugh ourselves to death, you know. We'd take that kid off there and put it out. She'd just walk, you know. And that kid's just all over the place. poor kid. I don't know how she ever turned out. It may have addled her brain. But, we just do some crazy things.
I was raised in Fancy Prairie, Illinois. Out in no man's land. We were very poor. My mother was Crystal. My dad's was William DeForest. And my mother came from a kind of aristocratic family. My dad was gassed in the First World War. And he had terrible coughing spells and he couldn't work much. He couldn't breathe well. My dad was what, 27? And she was 21 when they got married. And they had children right away, age one, two, three, four. Billy and Cordelia and me, Leahdell, and Daryl. And then they had Gwendolyn about 6 years later. And then after I got married, they had another one. That's Lou. Growing up was rough. Never had enough to eat, cold, not very many good times. I'm sorry. I didn't have till I went to high school. I didn't have good times because we had to work. And even if we could get on a box and stand and wash somebody's dishes, we had to do it. Yeah. That's the way we had to live. It was bad times. Yeah. High school, Elkhart High School, where I was born in Elkhart, but then my mom moved us out of Elkhart because there was taverns there. There wasn't any in Fancy Prairie. Get my dad out. And because he liked to, I think he played cards mostly. He loved to play cards. And he'd play, 10 cents a game or something. But that was a lot then. When I went to high school, it was wonderful. It was wonderful. I loved it. That was the happiest time of my life. I was determined I was going to be able to type and do everything. I was going out and get a job. I was going to do this and that, and I did. I did all sports. Baseball, basketball, volleyball. I was an excellent ping pong player. Best in school and in plays. I was determined I was going to do it. I was the first one that graduated from high school.
Well, we met at a filling station. I was pumping gas, and she was in her dad's truck, and she said I used to wink at her when she'd come in to get gas. Mm-hmm. I don't remember that, of course. I winked at all the girls.
Yes, he winked at all of them.
Good-looking ones, anyhow.
Yeah. Well, I thought he was cute. I really did, but I was very bashful. I was taught that you don't say or even notice anything. But I did. Pardon?
She wasn't as bashful as she was. That's on. Finally, I saw her. She was hanging out in a tavern.
I was not hanging out in a tavern.
Well, you were too. You was hanging over that jukebox the first time I saw you. And
that second time.
Second time I saw you, yeah.
Okay.
And I was sitting over there, and we bet $5 that one of us would get a date with you. The first one that got one had the other net to pay. He never did even ask you, I don't think.
No.
And I never did collect the $5 either. But anyhow, first date I met with her, she was with a friend of mine down in Springfield. While he was in getting something, I was over at the car talking to her and making a date for next Saturday night. And after that, why, she was the hottest thing in town.
On tape.
That good on tape.
It is too. Talk like that. That wasn't. That was when I was a senior, and went together about a whole year, and then he went to the Navy. Then when I got out of school, graduated, I got a job up in Chicago as a key punch operator at the Merchandise Mart, punching $10,000, $15,000, and $100,000 bomb stubs during the war. So we just decided we just go get married. And his mother didn't want him to marry me. That's right. So we just decided to save any problems, we just go get married. We did. June 20th, 1943. You give me an engagement ring, and I was superstitious, and I didn't want to see the ring before. So I stood outside the jewelry store while he went in and bought the wedding ring. And then we went down and got on the train, and we got off at Union Station in St. Louis. Lloyd called to get a justice of peace, and he found one. Then we got on a bus and went to St. Charles. We got off at this drugstore corner.
Did we? Okay.
Then we had to go get our license. Then we had to go, and he married us. He married us, and we went back and got on the bus, got back on the train, went back to Chicago, and we didn't have very long. We both had to go to work.
I had to be in by midnight, back on the bay.
Yeah, yeah.
Very romantic, you can tell.
Very romantic. Then we lived together about two months and a half, and he was gone for 2 years. And while he was gone, I worked for a ordnance depot, and we shipped out tank parts.
I went to aviation machines made school at Navy Pier in Chicago in the class of 365, and I was just a green old country boy at the farm, and I didn't know I knew anything.
Yeah.
Well, I qualified out of boot camp to go to school. They give you tests, you know. My mechanical aptitude was good. But I hadn't had much algebra and a lot of things I had to do, you know, in the school. I taught myself, and I ended up graduating number 5 in a class of 365. Mm-hmm. And I didn't think I'd even make it. Thought I'd flunk out. They'd send me out to put me on a battleship, swabbing a deck. But I ended up then from that school. Got to enough grade to go to a technical school at a university.
Mm-hmm.
Learned a hydraulic specialist.
Mm-hmm.
And wasn't as dumb as I thought I was.
And Lloyd used to play for square dances. See, Lloyd can play the violin and the banjo. And he and another friend played for dances. And that's how they made some money when he was young.
We had to come back to civilization, what I call Springfield.
Yes.
Worked in a garage. You sold it in Plymouth garage. No, you went and got pregnant.
I know. I did that all by myself.
Did you?
Yes.
Boy. Anyhow.
Linda was born in June. We bought a house and we fixed it up and sold it and made some money. Then we bought another one, fixed it up by ourselves. One day on this first house, I wanted an archway, and he didn't want to do it.
So I never did put an archway, you know.
Well,
but she thought
when
I
come
could,
home that day,
she thought I could do anything.
I took the wall out, and I got my archway.
See, I come home and there's plasters. She just tore the wall out.
Always cleaned up my messes.
She'd tear things up, but she couldn't put them back together. No,
but I knew he could.
Pick up the sledgehammer.
Yeah.
No, I did.
The lumberyard hated to see her come in because she wouldn't take a bad board, you know. She picked them up. Good ones.
Picked them out myself. And then they called him back in the Army. And that disrupted a lot. And he was out in California. And I went with him. And we had a little trailer we carried out there.
You don't carry them, Mother. You tow them.
I know. It felt like carrying them. We had Larry then to Fort Lewis in Washington. I didn't see him very often. He had a lot of problems with, he was a commanding officer. He had a lot of problems with men and couldn't come home, you know, for two or three nights at a time.
Like that.
Oh, that was the best years, you know. I'm telling you, your best years is your kids from the time they're born till what, 15?
Well, they don't check in with me till they're about 3 years old and they can walk around and do something. Get big enough, you can roughhouse with them.
Yeah.
And I like them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We went camping a lot with the kids.
Well, we used to go to Branson about every year for many years.
We'd always have their Christmas in the trunk of the car. But I'm finding out now that the kids always knew what they got because they was on the stairway where we couldn't see them, and we was putting everything together at night. Really did have a lot of fun, didn't we?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He was kind of the
fun one.
The wild one and the fun one.
He was the one that...
But everybody liked him,
mm-hmm.
and he wanted everybody to like him.
Mm-hmm.
But he was the one that's always the daredevil.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they built a fort out when we'd Mount Plaster. We had a big backyard. They built a fort out besides the long fence there. Out of boards, they'd go over to the lumber yard and snitch old boards at night and come over there and hammer them together and... They had quite a time. Other kids would come over and they'd play cowboy and Indian, you know. And this was Lee and Larry.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a couple of rooms built in there, you know, and it was kind of falling apart because it had just been tacked together anyhow. So I decided one day that one weekend we'd burn it. And because, you know, what you do with old lumber, you burn it and try to get rid of it. So it was quite a ways from the old barn that we'd made into a garage, but the old garage had shingle roof on it yet. I knew it was kind of dangerous, but I wanted to get it done. So pile all that wood up there and set it afire. But before I did that, I brought the hose out from the house and some buckets of water. So it was a blazing grate burning. And I looked up and my gosh, a spark or something got on the old dry shingles on the barn. And was burning, you know, just having a good time up there, merrily burning. I was on the fire department. So I told Leahdell, I says, call the fire department, our garage is on fire. So, and then Larry was there, so I sent him inside. It had a hay mow in it. I sent him up there with the hose. I said, hey, take this hose and you spray inside this roof right here where that fire's burned, see? And I got on the outside with a bucket of water and a can, and I was throwing water up on the roof. She went in to call the fire department.
Mm-hmm.
And man, I was wearing myself out trying to throw water, Larry was inside there with a garden hose. I was worried about him, but we finally got the thing put out. It just seemed like forever, you know, when you're doing something like that. And I was, where in the hell is the fire department? We're only about 5 blocks from the fire department. Sunday afternoon, you know, there'd been plenty of people around. She called in, she told them, hurry up, it's the Turners and their garage is on fire.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
that's what he told me.
Yeah, I said, go tell them, get down here. And when I got the fire out, they just showed up then. I didn't even need them. I said, well, it's a goddamn good thing I didn't need you guys. Where in the hell you been? Well, she said, we got a phone call that Turner's garage was on fire, and I had a garage up on the square. So they was up there messed around the garage. It was locked up and couldn't find any fire, you know, looking in the windows. The pumper's sitting there running ready to squirt water on things. And here the garage to 5 blocks away at home was on fire. It was a comedy of errors.
Yes.
You know, it could have... We're lucky we got it out before they came, because it was...
It was old.
And lucky I made precaution, took precaution to have things done. Time or later, Sonny came along. We was running out of L, so we had to name him Lloyd Jr.
Yeah, nobody would agree on a name.
But we never did call him Jr.
No.
I wouldn't allow that. I hated that. Mm-hmm. I hear a kid called Jr. I never liked it. So we called him Sonny.
Lee, he was crazy about animals, dogs. And we had lost our dog. And we told him we weren't going to have any more dogs. So he kept carrying everybody's dogs home. I mean, he carried any dog he could find. Great big ones, didn't he?
Yes.
And we didn't have any choice. We had to go get a dog because he was just taking people's dogs and carrying them home. So we went down to this veterinarian and asked him, do you know where we can get a dog? And he said, well, I've got one. He says, somebody brought it in to put it to sleep, but it had something wrong with it, and I fixed it. And he said, I just didn't tell him about it. So that was Sandy, because she looked at Dad and grinned, showed all her teeth and grinned at him. And that was, so we didn't have any choice. Anyway, he didn't carry any more dogs home. She was with us 22 years.
We got a bunch of pictures there that ATV racing that Larry took, and they're real pretty exciting.
Mm-hmm.
Always racing the water and the mud and, mm-hmm. and sharp turns and hills, you know.
Mud, a lot
and,
of mud.
Oh yeah, just mud all over the place.
Mud holes.
We'd make a mud hole if we didn't have any, you know.
Yeah.
State organization, first of all, we just did it locally, you know. Some of us get together and go out and race around, and kind of got pretty good at it. We went all over. We went as far as Ashtabula, Ohio, and Nashville, Tennessee, and raced and the nationals mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. so forth. And that went on for, I don't know how many years we did that.
I don't know, quite a few.
Lee, he'd grow, he'd win races. But he's kind of a driver, he'd tear a machine up getting
racing. But he'd win.
But he'd win.
Mm-hmm.
And him and Sonny got big enough, old enough to
Sonny
drive.
Sonny won too.
Sonny could win, but he never tore up the machine. That's just difference in, you know, driver.
Mm-hmm. Driver.
Guess who was judge?
I ran the races, mostly.
Guess who was the judge?
Who was the judge?
I was the judge.
Yeah, she did. Oh, judge
take judging.
Care of you keep it clean?
Yes, I kept her clean. We always went on a vacation every year, no matter what, by ourselves.
And we tried our best to get away once a month and go someplace like Chicago and see a stage show
or something,
or a theater
mm-hmm.
and spend a few days like that.
But well, I'm telling you, do it to your wife. No matter how old you get, go out, be by yourselves, because that's what holds a marriage together.
So many people let the kids rule their life, and I'm sure you've seen that. And that's one thing we never did. We never let the kids dominate our life, and we had to give our time to them wholly. Mm-hmm. We didn't. We took time for ourselves,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. and I think we kids were just as well off, maybe if not better,
mm-hmm.
for it.
What I love about Grandpa?
I'm good looking.
Well, not as good as you were. You're just like me.
Well, how about you? You're not as good as
I said, just like me. We're all sagging. You've been a good husband. You have.
Well, thank you. It's the first time you ever said that. Usually just griping at me.
I know.
What makes him such a good husband?
He's been a good provider, and he's been loving, and been good to his kids. Yeah, we work very well together. We built this house by ourselves, both of us. And God, I've never been any happier in my life than doing something like
She'd
that.
She'd rather do that than anything in the world. Yeah. It's just work and help me build.
Yes. Mm-hmm. He's just a good man. He's just a good man.
Nothing special. There are a lot of good men out there.
No, there isn't. I don't believe that.
You don't believe that?
No.
Yeah.
No, Pop. I don't believe that.
Oh, she's such a good-looking woman. And she just works hard, takes care of me and the kids and the dogs and the cats and keeps the house clean, does the washing, you know. I mean, I just couldn't get along without her. She's been a good woman, a good wife. A couple times I'd like to toss her out, but that soon passed. We just kind of met, and it just, that was it, you know. I mean, there's nobody else, for me, anyhow.
Yeah, when you meet the right one, you know. I don't care how good looking they are or how much money they got, it doesn't make any difference. When you meet the right one.
You just get stupid and get married.
Yeah, you just do that.